Today we're going to spend just a couple minutes looking at a Reset CSS. So I've downloaded the Reset CSS zip from our class website, and notice that I've dropped it into our Project 3 demo folder. We're going to look at page-specific CSS in a moment, but I have the Reset CSS sitting right here. In it, I've given you an index file and just a Reset CSS file that we're going to look at. I've also gone ahead and set up my Dreamweaver site, so it's looking at my website folder, and there, of course, within Project 3 demo are my files, so there's the Reset CSS. Let's go look at our index file. I'm going to go ahead and open that one up. So if we open that one up, let me find the edge of it here. So if we open that one up, you'll notice that it's just a pretty basic page layout, kind of similar to where we've been already. We just have a series of divs. So I have an A, which is an H1, a heading 1 right here, and it's sitting within a div with an ID named A. I also have a B div with some text, a C div with some text, and again a D down here at the bottom. So pretty basic, straightforward layout as far as things go. The thing that I want to look at today is how we get some inconsistencies in browsers with CSS. So I actually want to go look at this index file in a couple of browsers. So I have a couple of browsers launched at the moment. I have a Safari running, and we're going to look at something here in a minute. But I can take an HTML file and I can drag it onto a browser icon and it'll open that local file. So I'm going to drag it right over here onto my Safari icon, and then there's my file now open in Safari. And you can know that you're looking at a local one if you look right up here at the top. Instead of getting the HTTP, notice it starts with file colon. Okay, so I'm looking at a local file in this case. I'm going to go back to the Finder and grab this one, and I have Firefox running as well. So I'm going to drag this onto my Firefox icon, and now I have it open in two different browsers. So what I want to do is I want to compare how this sits in my two browsers. So I'm going to try and match my two browser windows. So I'm going to match width on them, because see how the type is here in the C, the paragraph underneath C. As I make it wider, it reflows. So to get accurate match, I'm going to match the width of my two browsers. And then notice that they each have a little bit more overhead, if you will, up here. So I'm going to match the starting point. So you see how I've aligned them. So you see right here how they're now aligned. So I've matched the width of my browsers, and I have them starting at the same point right here. So in theory, these should match. But notice as the page moves on, so see, this is Firefox in the front. You see how Firefox is displaying it a little bit different than Safari is here in the back. If we brought it up in Chrome, it would look just a little bit different as well. So my point being that they don't match exactly. Now, the CSS we're looking at here, if we come back to our file, and if I wanted to modify something here, I could go in and look for the CSS. So if I select my C, that's an H1, and if I come look over my CSS designer, there is no CSS right here right now. You notice I have no sources. If I look in code, there's the head right there. There are no rules here. There are no style tags. There are no linked CSS files. So there's nothing for me to modify. We've seen this before, and you've probably become accustomed to it, but maybe you haven't thought about the fact that there is something already going on with the CSS here, even though we don't have any rules. And so what you're looking at is CSS that is built into the browsers already. So it's what makes an H1 be larger like that. Or if I hit a return and say subhead, and I come down here and tell it to be an H2, the H2 of course is a little bit smaller than the H1. Actually, both of them are bold by default, and those are just built into the browsers already. So we don't really have control. You can override them, but we can't just control what the browsers do. And so that's why you see the inconsistency between the browsers here. So, not only do we have the challenges in web design that are, different than print design, where we put something on the page and it's exactly where we want it, and you print it on the printing press and it stays there, but we also have the inconsistencies in browsers. And so what we want to do is we want to look at how we can zero those out by resetting our CSS before we start building our own CSS for our own site. So, I'm going to go back over to Dreamweaver. Here's my file I'm working in. And you know what? Actually, before I apply it, I want to show you something else. I'm going to come back over to Safari, which I was using as my primary browser. And I want to show you this page here. So this is on meyerweb.com. It's a guy named Eric Meyer, and he does a lot of CSS work. He actually figures out how to do a lot of things with CSS that people might not know how to do initially. And one of the things he's done is he's worked on this reset CSS idea, which has been around for quite a while. In fact, he links right here to a discussion back in May of 2007. So it's been around a while. And he has developed a reset CSS file that is a really good starting point for what we're trying to do here. So if we scroll down, he actually shows it to us right here. This is the whole code of it right here. Let's scroll down just a little bit. Okay, that's all of it right there. Notice that most of it, majority of it right here, is just a list of tags. Okay, so a whole series of HTML tags, and you see that just the margins are zeroed, the padding is zeroed, border is zeroed, and so forth. So we're just zeroing out, resetting a bunch of settings so that we have just a clean starting point. So that's the majority of what this does. You can look through all of these rules here. He also has, if you look right above it, right here where it says you can grab a copy of the file, that links to the actual reset CSS file. So either way, you could highlight this and copy and paste it, or you could download it right here from his site. Also, in the sample files I've given you, I told you I gave you the index file here. This reset.css file is a copy of his, okay? It's not been modified, so that's exactly the same. So when you're working on a lab assignment or later when you're working on a project for class and I ask you to use the reset, that's a clean copy if you want to use it, or you can go download one from his site again. So let's look at linking our HTML to that and see how that affects our pages. So I'm going to go back over to Dreamweaver. There's my page, of course. I currently have no CSS sources. So I need to come up here to sources and I need to add one. And I want to attach an existing CSS file. This is the reset one. So I'm going to attach that one. I'm going to go use my browse button. And let's see, I'm working in Project 3 demo. It took me there. And I'm going to go look in my reset CSS folder. And there's my reset.css file. So I'm going to select that one and say open, and then I'm going to click on the OK button. Now notice what it did immediately. It reset all of these. It took the sizes away. It made everything be right about the same size. It took the margin and the padding off of things. That's a few students have struggled with that already this semester, where you end up with space above and below, like the H1 and the H2. It was more than they wanted, and they weren't sure how to get rid of it. So this zeroes you out to a really good starting point here. So I'm going to go up to File and I'm going to say Save. Now I'm going to go back to my browsers. So there's Safari. There's the page I'm looking at. So remember, this is a local file I'm looking at. I've saved it, so I can just do a refresh, and there we go. And I'm going to go to Firefox and I'm going to tell it to refresh. And it's a whole lot closer. We still actually see a little bit of a difference. Looks like the biggest difference, I wonder if my widths are the same. Yeah, they're really close. The biggest difference we see is, see how this word right here is kicked down a line. Let's cheat it and make it go up. Okay, we're still off a little bit. Oh no, I see. The biggest difference is that I'm not aligned there. There, now we're much better. So see how our alignment is so much better than we were a minute ago. In fact, I push this back, yeah. So it looks like it's got a slight difference between the two of them, but we're much closer than we were to begin with. So this is how we can zero these out and give us a nice clean starting point. So if you start with this reset, then you zero all your settings, and now you can go ahead and start creating your CSS. So I would recommend, when you're starting to build a page, that you have a copy of the reset CSS file in your root folder, and that you link it to your page before you start building any of your CSS. Let's go look at our code here for a second. Here's the head, and then notice right here, there's the link pointing to our reset CSS. So I'm going to act as if I'm going to start creating my own CSS. And the way I'd like you to do it is to actually generate another CSS file. Create another CSS file to put your rules in. So I'm going to come over to CSS Designer and add another source. Click on the plus, and I'm going to create a new CSS file. I'm going to browse. Okay, let's go back. I'm working in Project 3 Demo in the Reset CSS folder. And I'm going to give it our standard name, styles.css, and say save. And say OK. OK, now I have two sources. So Reset CSS has all of his rules. Style CSS is where I want to put my rules. So let's go back over to code again for a moment. And I want to point out the order these are in. So we linked to his first, and of course that puts his first, and then we've added ours after that, therefore ours sits afterwards. You need to do it in this order, so that you get your reset first, because the reset zeroes things out. If you were to start working on a file and start generating your CSS rules, and then midway through you go, oh, I forgot my reset, and you go back and link, then these would be out of order. So you now have a file that you have your styles followed by the reset. Okay, I just drug those, change the order of those. If you were to do this, you would be creating your styles, and then when someone requests your page, you know, the browser goes and gets it from the server, and it starts working its way down through the file. It would hit this point that it reads your styles in, and then it would hit the reset. So this would undo a lot of your styles. Okay, so the reset has to go first. So if you find yourself in this situation where you've got them in the wrong order, you can simply go grab the reset and you can drag it up here, or you can always do a command X so you can cut it, put your cursor where you want it to be, and do a command V, a paste, and get them in the right order. Important thing is you need your reset before your styles, okay? So make sure you do them in that order. I do want to point out that in the future, if you ever want to combine these into the same CSS file, you can't do that. You could always open the reset CSS, copy all those rules, and paste them at the beginning of your style sheet. Of course, again, they need to go first, so put them at the top of yours. So you start with the reset rules, then you start building your rules after that. So there's nothing wrong with having them in the same file. For the purpose of class, I'm going to ask you to put them in two different files because I want you to work with two files, get used to that possibility, working that way, and I want you to think about the reset and what that does, and then think about your set of rules. Have a clear understanding of how that's working. By using the reset, again, it has undone some of the defaults that are there. So you're probably going to end up creating a couple additional rules that you might not have had to otherwise. But in the end, it's going to give you a cleaner set of CSS. The other thing that I want to point about the reset CSS, let's go look at it. Here are his rules. This is a starting point, and I want you to view it that way. So Eric Myers put, you know, a fair amount of work in here. But even he says this isn't the end-all solution to it all. So feel free to modify this if you feel like there are some things that you would like to work differently. Let's see, as an example, let's see a couple of examples. One is, you notice right here, in his, the unordered list, the UL, and the ordered list, the OL, he sets for list style none. We remember that from when we created button navigation. That removes, like on an unordered list, that removes the bullets. So he has a reset that removes bullets or numbers from all of our lists. And you might not want that to be your default across all lists. So maybe that's something you don't like. You want to modify that. Or another thing, actually this is one I like to modify. On the body tag, he has line height set to 1. I don't really like line height set to 1. You see how tight this type is right here, and as a default I tend to like it more like 1.3. Okay, so if that's the case, you can always modify your reset rules and create your own reset that you use on an ongoing basis. Okay, so don't be afraid to modify this one and kind of develop your own set of reset CSS that you would use moving forward.